This is the fourth video of our computer-aided archaeology course. And in this video, or in this session, we want to get really practical with starting with our database. And because of that, this theoretical introductory video will be rather on the short side, because there are 45 minutes of practical videos waiting for you. So jump right in, although we start with a bit of rehearsal. Remember, we talked about the entity relationship model, a model with which you can design your database in a way that you have entities. These are most of the time objects in the real world that represents stuff about which you would like to have some information. And because the world is not flat, most of the time you have different levels of hierarchy, different things that are connected to each other, and these connections are represented via these relationships. So we have entities, relationships, hence the name. And yeah, we have talked about that, and this entity relationship model comes with different possibilities to visualize them. So this is one way of visualizing these. And you can also see that we have here some numbers here. These are the relationships. That means one site can have any number of artifacts, but an artifact can have only one site. And these are the different cardinalities of the relationships. We talked about that. We can have N2M, where one object here can be linked to multiple objects from the other entity, but also one object here from this entity can be linked to multiple objects from the other entity. If we have a situation like before, where we have one site and the artifact, of course an artifact should come from one and only one site. So we have here a asymmetrical relationship, which is described as 1 to M. And if we have the situation where one object from here can only be linked to one other object from the other entity, we have a one-to-one relationship here. What is essential to map these relationships are keys, primary keys. These are identifiers for each individual record, and they must be unique to be able to really identify this one entity, this one object, and not multiple of them. And I told you, you can either use an existing set of attributes that are unique for each record, and that is probably the theoretical best way to go, because we reduce the number of columns. But in practice, most of the time you will have an ID column, which is a consecutive number going from one to whatever maximum number of objects you have, and this will then definitely identify your object without that you have to rely on that the other objects are unique. Because for example, C14 dates, you can have multiple records on these C14 dates, and although one lab code and one lab number should identify one C14 date, you cannot be sure that this is always the case. So it's often better to design a database like that, that you have an independent identifier as your primary key. And with the primary key, you can link things to other things. For example, if we have sites and burials, if the sites have a primary key, you can link the individual burials to the site using the primary key of sites as a foreign key in the burial column, to identify that this burial here belongs to site 1, while this burial here that has the same name belongs to site 2. So in that case, in that sense, these keys are what actually defines the relationship between the objects, and it makes sense that you have a reasonable way of naming these things. Most of the time, it's probably the easiest if you have a column ID where your primary key is stored, and then the name of the other table of the other entity plus underscore ID to name the foreign key in that table. And we talked about normalization. I will not go into detail here. If you still unsure what it means, you can go back to the other presentation from last time. It basically is putting into a structural way a common sense idea how you should structure your data, that these are not redundant, randomly stored, which can lead to ambiguities in your data set. So you should go through a normalization. And so there are multiple normalization normal forms here. Most of the time it's enough that your data are to the third normal form normalized, and from that on everything else is more academic than real practical use. Okay, so I said third normal form should be enough, and now we want to get practical. We have here again the different possibility of sites. Most of them or you have already decided on which kind of data set, which site you want to work on. And in the practical session this week, you should have a proper idea what information you would like to record, what the entities and the relationships are between the different levels of information that you have, and what your attributes of the entities are, and how we transform them into tables. Well, this comes naturally then if we have the entities, but from a practical side we have also to use some software to really make a database and not have such just a thought experiment here. And that will be the topic of this lecture part this time. So here I will give you just an overview, and then I will link the practical videos for the individual steps also on the course website. First, you have your draft. However it looks like, you can use a blackboard, you can use paper, mind map, or an actual entity relationship designing tool. There are several out there. Here you can see what it looked like in the last iteration of our course, where we had site, grave, artifact, and the different information about them, and also other information here too. And I think we will also come up with a solution like this in our session then this week. But for the time being, we will use that from last time, and also we will use the database that last time was there as a role model how we will design that. So in that situation with the Mikovice database, we came up with the structure that we have sites and graves, because it was a graveyard kind of, and a grave can belong only to one site, but sites can have multiple graves, and we have recorded some information about them. And in the graves we wanted to record different things, the individuals, the skeletons or buried persons. We wanted to have some information about them, some information about the artifacts, and some information about the C14 dates. And these are probably kind of independent from each other, because of course you will have a C14 date from an artifact, probably from an individual if you have a bone, but it can also be charcoal that's not actually an artifact, so that's why we structured it like that. So that was just the table structure of the things that we actually want to record, but we make it a bit more complicated, because what we also have to add here are the primary keys, always this ID column, and to capture the relationships we also add the foreign keys. So for the graves we need a column site ID, which gets the site IDs for the sites for the individual graves, and the same is true for the individuals. Here we need a grave ID. We do not need a site ID, because that follows automatically from graves, and so this is a way also of normalizing the things. If we know the grave ID for an individual, we can easily identify via a query, for example, to which site this individual belongs. And this is true for all the other tables, objects in our database. But then we make things a bit more complicated, because currently we record sex and age here as strings, and type of the artifact also as strings and material. And that's possible from a normalization point of view, but that gives a lot of options here. So because of that, we added lookup tables. And lookup tables are tables that store a certain set of information. For example, sexes, I don't know, male, female, undecided, undefined, you can have different things here. For ages, since we're dealing with here with anthropological ages, that's juvenile, mature, senile, and stuff like that. We have here also an ages table, and with that it becomes actually also more flexible, because we can also add other kind of age information here. And the same is true for types. And with this, we narrow down the possibilities of entry. You cannot have a free text field where you can enter everything. You just have to, you always have to think about what type you will take into your catalog, and then you can add that with type ID to the artifact, and not have a free text field where people can write everything in there. Probably if you work alone, you will probably be very structured and will not have any problem here. But as soon as you start collaborating with others, it's better to narrow down this, and makes it more complicated to just enter any value that might be possible here, trying to formalize and standardize stuff more. That's why these lookup tables are quite important from a practical point of view. Okay, now we have to see how this works in the actual database program, and we will work here with LibreOffice Base. Their tables are stored as tables, so when you open the program later on, you will see that there is here a button tables, and there you will see the tables for different entities that we just defined. And relationships primary consists of the primary and the foreign keys that we have defined already before. So with that, from a database perspective, everything is set up. But from a practical point of view, most database desktop programs give you a tool to define these relationships upfront. And with that, you will have some predefined relationships when you do some, for example, queries or forms. Then you can use this already defined structure to ease the creation of the queries and the forms. Things will look a bit different in Microsoft Access. I have no experience whatsoever, I have to admit, with FileMaker, but I assume that there will also be a similar structure, because this reflects the basic structure of this relational database philosophy. Okay, so we will have some tables, and these are the main information that are stored here in tables, and we will have some relationships that are consisting of the primary and foreign keys, but they will also be reflected here in the relationship tool. You will see how this works in practice in the practical videos. Okay, to start, we need at first to create a new database. For that, we have to open LibreOffice Base. And the first dialog you will see is select the database, either open existing database or create a new one. We will create a new one, and we will use the standard database system that LibreOffice offers us. We can directly click on finish. There is another next button where you can specify other things that are currently not so important for us. If the database should be registered for use, for example, in other Office tools, we can just leave it by default and click on finish, and then you will be asked to save your database. Please save your database in a reasonable folder that you can have access to it, and probably if you work in your team with a shared storage with a cloud storage, save it there, but still keep a reasonable folder structure also for your database, because your database will be only one file within probably a larger project where also other informations will be stored. Remember what we have talked in the second part of the second lecture, you should have a reasonable data structure. I haven't built up here one for this experiment, so this is just my blank document folder, but for a real project I would have here a bit more reasonable data structure. Okay, to start the whole thing, you simply have to open LibreOffice Space, create a new database, click on finish and save it somewhere where you will find that later on. Then, as I said, most important are the tables in a database. They store your information on specific items, and these are usually represented as rows with different columns. If you just double click on one of the tables, you will see this dialog open. Different rows representing different items, different columns representing different fields of your database, different informations. If you right click on an existing database, you will see the editor here with which you can define the fields and the data type for that. We will start with new, how to create a table in the practical video. But just to give you context, so the tables are where your information goes, and you have to define them first. You have to create a table using the database, the table creation tool here, the editor for the table. That's the first step. Usually you have to define your tables, and then if you have all your tables, you define your relationships. Actually, you have already defined your relationships with the primary and the foreign keys in your tables, but with this tool, most of the time with some graphical user interface, you can link these tables, arrange them here somehow in this view, and then link things. If, for example, you click on the ID of graves and drag it over to grave ID and say these are connected, and with that you define the relationships. Also, you will see how this practically works in the practical video. And as I said before, this is only for your convenience. For the database perspective, it's actually not necessary, but it eases things later on if you use the database. The next step then, which is covered in the tutorial videos, are forms. Forms, like in the real world, structure information and also helps you to ease the input. So on the one hand, you can structure the form so that it's easy to input the data in a systematic way. It also enables to select values with lookup tables. We haven't any lookup table here at the moment, but if there's some, this refers to the lookup to the drop-down field. These refer to the lookup tables, and you can just click on one of these drop-down fields and select a value, and then in the background the actual ID of this lookup table for this lookup table is then stored in your data set, and you don't have to remember all the IDs. You can select the name and then the ID is actually stored, which helps very much, except for if you have a photographic brain and you will always be able to remember what material 33 was. So in most of the cases you will have some drop-down fields here, and with these drop-down fields and with the structure that we have set up with the lookup tables, the forms limit in structure the possibility entry values so that not every value can be entered there. So you can also then only select those values that you have in the lookup table and not invent something new here. What you can also do with forms is to enable subforms to enter data from different into different tables at once. For example, here we have a table where we have site, the site name, the grave number, information about the grave. So we can start. Oh, this is actually a drop-down field. Now I see a drop-down field. Site, so we can select which site we want to put information for, or give new graves, enter new graves. But down here we have some subforms that enables us to enter information about the artifacts, the buried individuals there, can be multiple individuals of course per grave, and also the C14 dates with the BP and the standard deviation all in one form. And you can nest these forms as deep as you like, as deep as it may be reasonable for you. Most of the time you probably will have only two levels of subforms in one of these forms here. So with that you can have a decent entry form for all your data, and this totally depends on your workflow, how you structure that. Probably in this case we will enter the sites in the table directly. You can always do that. And then we will use this information from the lookup table, because here we have only one site and it doesn't make sense to have a specific subform for this situation. But when there are more information about the sites than the name, and you will have to enter them quite often, it makes sense to have also a subform for the sites here embedded, so that we have all the information in one go if we record, if we scan through the catalog of the actual site, then we can enter everything that's necessary in one go. Your task then in the next 2 weeks will be to enter the data from your site into your database that you have designed according to your database design and that you have implemented with the help of the tutorial videos. Please distribute this work. Do that together, decide who will enter what. Most of the time it makes sense to divide on the main object level, for example graves, these into number ranges that people, that one of you will start with the first 30, the next with the next 30 and so on. And then it also makes sense to exchange that and have a look, check the data entry of the other persons to be sure that the values are correct here. And what then follows, and also therefore we will have a video how we can get the video, the information out again. Most desktop database systems offer some wizards and tools to create this query. So queries are a structured way to receive the information. Question for the database, you ask for specific things and you get back specific information. And these wizards can look different. I know the one from Access, I know this one from Base, and they are essentially the same. You have here, down here you define your query, what kind of information you would like to get. In this case it's the grave ID and the construction of the grave with some code here, and then we have the name of the sex of the buried individuals, and that should be male because we're here only interested in the male burials for whatever reason. And you can create this query by dragging the tables over here. If you have defined the relationships already, they will be automatically displayed here, and then you select the information, the columns that you would like to see. And if there is a column that will be a query column, a condition, then you can write the criterion in here and with that select the data that you would like to have. You will see that in the practical part. In the background, this will always, nearly always be SQL, Structured Query Language, or SQL, how the cool kids call it. And this looks like that. It's actually not very complicated, it's human readable. Select these informations from these tables, where, here gets a bit more complicated, the sex's name should be male. And then we have to also link these things, we have to reflect the relationships in the query, and that's what takes place here. The sex's ID should be the same as the individual's sex ID, and the grave ID should be the same as the individual's grave ID, and with that we have these connections here from graves to individuals to sexes. And down below here, that's the actual query that we select only males. And well, together, all in all, it's a query because we have to define what information we would like to have, from where we would like to have, and what conditions these informations should follow. So SQL as such is not complicated, but it can also be very practical to use these wizards to create your queries. You will also see that in the specific video for that. That should be enough for this introductory video. Have fun with all the practical videos, and please, we will prepare that in this week's practical session. Please enter your dates as much as we will together decide on into the database, and then we will be ready for next time when we will start with using these dates in different forms and make use of the huge data collection that we will have. If there are any questions, here are the usual ways to contact me beside the Slack channel where you can also contact me. And with that, I wish you happy data entry and happy video watching, and we'll see each other soon.